we'll have our first attempt at 11s. If you don't know what 11s are, you could do a little bit of research ahead of time, or you could just show up for some informal gathering of conversation over tea and coffee and maybe some noshing, and we'll just see where the morning takes us. Also, our adult programs team is meeting Wednesday at 10 a.m. This will be a joint meeting both here at the Meeting House and on Zoom. So if you are interested in joining that meeting, you can find more information on how to connect in our e-bulletin or the events calendar on our website. You can find more information about any of our events. You can find information about any of our events on our calendar on our website. And if you have information that you'd like to share with us, please get it to the office no later than Tuesday of the week that you'd like to have it shared. Do we have any visitors who would like to introduce yourselves this morning? Yes. One second, because people who are joining us on Zoom will only hear you with the microphone.
Eileen McCabe and my partner and I were members here for 12 years before we moved to Florida, where we are very active members at UU.
Welcome back. Are you a visitor who's joining us for the first time?
Stephen Rahm, it's been 3.5 years since the virus began, and that was the last time I was here. So I think I would consider myself a visitor. If I'm here next week, I'm no longer a visitor. It has been very hard, to say the least, and I miss my family. Thank you very much for letting me back in here. Because you know I'm all crazy. Thank you again.
If you are here by the end of this hour, then you are no longer a visitor. If you are there by the end of this hour, you are no longer a visitor. And however you join us, you are welcome. And we are delighted to have you. If you are visiting here in the Meeting House, we invite you to sign our guest book in the fellowship hall. If you're joining us online, we invite you to sign our virtual guest book. The link for that should be popping up in your chat. Either way, someone from our care and connection team will be in touch with you. Also in your chat, you can find today's order of service, a link for today's order of service, including how to follow along to this service and ordinarily the words for the songs that we'll be singing, but all of those for all of us will be on screen. I'm going to hand you the microphone because, I can explain what you are saying to the folks who are joining us online, but I actually don't know what it is that you are saying. You're saying our video is cut, which means we don't have video. Does that mean that we are not able to be with the people? So if you're joining us online, then you can't see us, but you can hear us. If you're joining us online or in the Meeting House, can you see the videos of the hymns that we'll be playing later today? Yes. However you're joining us, you can hear the videos of the hymns that we'll be playing later. And so This is an in-gathering welcome back service. If you haven't been here ever, or if you haven't been here in a long time, there's never a dull week. There's always some excitement. When the tech is happening, there is always lots of busyness. That keeps things exciting and interesting. We here aim for an experience that is moving and that is memorable, never one that is perfect. And I do want to encourage everyone, even our tech people. One of the things that's making this especially interesting today is we've lost our little buffer for this microphone. So I might actually try switching myself to this microphone. So now I feel like a lounge singer or a stand-up comedian, which might be fitting for what's happening because I can move around and not be tethered to the podium. I'm going to invite all of us to take a deep breath. And maybe a second one. Some things are not going the way some of us planned or anticipated or hoped for this morning. And that is okay. We are here. We are here. Even if you can't see us, you can hear us. And you can see us.
Yes, you're back.
How brilliant. Thank you. This week, after our long return from the summer, we get to celebrate water communion. Water communion is an opportunity for us to join together. That is the communion part, to remember and pay attention and celebrate the ways that we are all interconnected with each other. And it is a water communion. It is a way, an opportunity for us to celebrate also our interdependence with this planet, especially with its water, which is a source of all of our lives. You might know that this planet is about 70% water, and like it, our bodies are about 70% water. And though we can live for about a month without food, it wouldn't be pleasant. We can barely survive 3 days without water. It is perhaps our most valuable resource. And I think all of us are feeling the ways that it is threatened. And so this week, we celebrate water and we remember water and we remind ourselves of who we are and how we are and how we want to be in this world. We begin this worship by lighting our chalice, which is a symbol of our shared faith. I think Sue is going to actually do the firing up with these words from Katie Gelfand. We light this chalice as a symbol of reunion. We reunite in this sanctuary to share the flow of our hearts with one another. We gather together in rituals to celebrate our fountains of joy, to hold each other through storms of grief, to guide one another through rapids of transformation, to rest together on the ponds of stillness. Together, we honor the spirit of water, its many forms, and its life-giving essence. This first song that we'll sing together, Rising If You Feel Willing and Able, is Spirit of Life. Our first message this morning is a story. I love stories. And this one, I think, is a doozy. It is an Indian tale retold by Deepa Balsavar and then re-retold by me. This is a once upon a time story. So once upon a time, way out on the outskirts of a dusty village, a tiny bird searched for a place to lay her eggs. The land was parched and dry, and there wasn't a bush in sight. And so finally, in desperation, this little bird discovered a shallow depression in the ground, just like a tiny little dent in the ground. And using her claws to remove the stones and to loosen up the packed earth, she broadened the dent and made it a little bigger, a tiny hole. And there, underneath the hot sun, she laid her eggs. The eggs were hatched, and the good mother protected and fed her babies until they were big enough to fly away. And here, our story would have ended, except this isn't only a tale about a little bird, but a much more, I hope, interesting one of the whole that she used as a temporary nest. Now, a hole, you are thinking, what could be interesting about a hole in the ground? Well, this hole grew to be quite important. So here we go. For a good while, the hole remained dusty and vacant. Until one day, a wild boar was passing through. The wild boar settled his rump into the little hole in the ground. The fit wasn't quite comfortable enough. Maybe you experienced this when you got here. And so the wild boar moved his little bottom around and made the hole fit a little better until it was perfect for his proportions. Backing into this hollow, he turned around a few times and with a satisfied grunt, settled down for a long snooze. And it was a long snooze. The boar turned and scrabbled in his sleep, loosening the earth even more until his cozy little dugout under the fading sun told him that it was time for him to go. His stomach rumbled. He needed to go and find food. But when he left, he turned back and gave his comfy landing place, his comfy nap hollow, a glance. And what was it, you are probably thinking? Well, his hole was a little bit bigger, comfortable for more wild boar to come and rest and not have to do so much work. Is that it? I can tell you're thinking, that's the story. No, that is not the story. There's more. So after the wild boar, a pack of wild dogs, catching the scent of boar, came to the spot where it had been. They sniffed the circle that was rich with the smell of the animal. They whined and snarled and dug at the smell as if they might find the boar itself, but nothing. And as they clawed and traveled looking for the source of that delicious boar scent, the hole got bigger and wider than they had found it. And then what happened? That's what I would be thinking. And then what happened? Do other animals come along after that? Well, as a matter of fact, there is more to this story. Because not long after the bird and then the boar and then the wild dogs, finally, the rain came. It poured and poured, and only those who had seen monsoons can really understand what that meant. It rained without stopping for days, 3 days, three nights. The dry earth soaked up the moisture. As hungry as a little cat lapping up milk, the whole earth smelled fresh and wet. And even the most serious of people delighted. Folks walked around with smiles and glee on their faces. That hole in the ground collected all of that water that had fallen, and all around it, the earth was bright and green and rich with life. Soon, the buffaloes discovered the grassy spot around the hole. And as buffaloes tend to do, they wallowed in the muddy puddle, making it muddier, but also larger. And so now what was left was a big old giant muddy pit, surrounded by the beautiful lushness and green that the rain had brought. This became a watering hole. And then they lived happily ever after. Not quite. Not quite. That rarely happens in a story like this. Then what happened is that a poor farmer tilled his land near what had once been a very small depression. This farmer's life was hard, and the rains and the dry periods were often cruel. In the summer months, he had to travel far and far and further just to get water for his tiny, thirsty crops. His harvest was meager. One day, not that long after the rains, he straightened up from his back-breaking work and looked out over the land. And what did he see? But out towards the horizon, just beyond his pitiful little piece of dry land, his eyes came to rest upon this beautiful patch of green, life-filled land. Going closer to investigate, the farmer fell to the ground with gratitude at the sight of this verdant bowl. Here was water to be had. Enough water for him, certainly. And so close to his own farmland. Forgetting how tired he was, he raced home and he brought his pickaxe and his spade. And just like the buffalo and the bird and the boar before him, he picked and axed at that land, making this muddy puddle beautiful, wet, fresh water pond. Is this story ever going to end with a moral? That's what I thought when I was reading it, at least. Well, maybe not. But there is something to learn even when there's no moral at the end. So the happy farmer created his pond full of water. He went to celebrate with his wife. His wife summoned the village priest. The village priest came and prayed over this pond in gratitude. All of the villagers, happy for their friend and neighbor, came also to be a part of this blessing, of this gift of water that was theirs. And that would be the end of it, except not. Because just then, as the town, the village people gathered, the rich farmer of the village saw that something was going on that he was not a part of, and that could not be. He went to see what was happening, pushed and elbowed his way to the front of the crowd, looked at the beautiful pond that had not been there before, and the farmer and the priest and all the villagers who were so happy, and pronounced, "I see you all have come to bless my pond." "Your pond?" the farmer asked. "I helped to create this pond." "Well, maybe," replied the rich farmer. "But your land ends just over there. This is the beginning of my property." And the rich farmer and the poor farmer stared each other down, and the villagers looked on. The poor farmer thought, "Surely, surely, all of the work I did had a role in creating this pond." And the wild dogs looked on, and the boar looked on, and the bird looked on, and all of them thought, "Surely, surely I had something to do with this." And so the question, because I warned you, there is no moral, but a question: who owns the water? Just a thought to think about this morning, and maybe more later. May your roots grow deep. May your branches spread far. May you find this world to be a wonderful place and leave it better for those who follow. We support the work of this congregation in many ways, through the gifts of our time and our talent and also our treasure. Your financial contributions help to support the ongoing work of this congregation, including worship and religious exploration, community care and connection. It also helps to support the ways that we are able to show up in our community for justice and community care. Your contributions to the Helping Hand Fund go to support local organizations in need, a portion of which goes to the Minister's Discretionary Fund, which helps individuals in immediate need. As you all rifle through your pockets and give generously, we'll hear a little more music from Robert Zechrist. If you're joining us online, you can contribute using the PayPal link in your chat. However you share, whatever you share, it will be gratefully received.
Thank you.
In case you can't hear, Robert, there is audible gasping and applause in the meeting house. This is the time in our share time when we share our. I am going to invite you to take a deep breath. And to loosen your body, if you will, as we deepen into this moment of meditation. Our meditation this morning on The Strength of Water by Jamila Batchelder and Molly Hausch Gordon. Don't forget to breathe. The strength of water takes on many, many forms. Just as each of you has a unique and necessary strength that you bring to our community and to the work of love. Take a moment now to drop down into that deep wellspring of your own spirit and bathe yourself in the strength that is the groundwater of your person. Are you a roaring wall, a roaring fall, wearing rock away with the sheer force of will? Are you a tiny drop of water in a crevice, breaking it open slowly and steadily? Are you buoyant, like the Great Salt Lake, practiced at holding others aloft? Are you tenacious, like a mountain stream, finding your way down and around every obstacle you face? Are you still and calm, like the pond at daybreak, offering radiant peace by your shores? Are you in touch with hidden depths, pulling from a vast well? Do you soothe like the steam rising from a cup of tea, or dissolve away stubborn muck like water left in a pot to soak? Do you soften and smooth the edges like a creeping fog, or clear away distraction like a cleansing rain? Do you roll with the ebb and flow like the ocean waves? Settle your mind upon the strength, the power that is yours. Draw that strength into your heart. Draw it up into your soul. As we gather together the many waters of this community, we need each of your power, each of your resilience, each of your love to make us whole. This next song, hymn that we will sing together,
There is a river flowing in my soul. Many thanks to our friends at the UU congregation in Baltimore for that. So this is the actual communion part of our water communion, where you are invited, if you have brought water from your travels far or near, to come and add it to our common bowl. If you have not brought water, but have a story of water that has been meaningful to you in this year, you can bring that too, with some of this water to add to our common bowl. And so now I stop talking. If you're joining us on, oh, I don't stop talking. If you're joining us online, please do unmute yourself and we will proxy your water to our common bowl. You have to walk up.
I'm Sue, and as much as I love this community, another one that feeds me is Star Island. So I have my pretend water from Star Island, and also a few days with Margie Polkingham on Lake Armington in New Hampshire. So she says hi to all.
The town of East Hampton spent probably enough money on putting pipes into the ground because the water is contaminated from the airport, and it did not obviously cross their minds to close the airport. And because the fuel leakage from the jet planes, so the millionaires and billionaires can fly their helicopters and jets in, has contaminated the ground. So consequently, everybody now has if you chose, pipes running into their house. It turns out you had an option. We opted not to have it. It is now also turning out that those who have well water, like we do, have better quality water than the pipe water. So, and it didn't cost us anything. So we're going to stay with it. And they also announced that if the power goes out, you may not have well water. They've already cut back and doubled the price of the water. So East Hampton is doing what it usually does. We have sufficient filters and everything. Jim, I would just like to say that somehow in our house, the amount of steps going from upstairs to downstairs, from downstairs to upstairs has doubled. I don't know how it happened, but also if the other people in the room, somehow every time I go upstairs, what I need, I left downstairs. And when I get downstairs, I remember what I need is upstairs. So to all of you that will eventually get close to 80, it's really fun.
Hi, so this is water from my pool, and you might be thinking, well, why'd you bring that water? I brought it because all summer I've spent 99.9% of my time in my pool because it is extremely hot. And I've invited almost all my friends over, and it's just been like one of the happiest places at my house, and it just makes me happy. So yeah.
This represents the salt water that I miss so much. As I watched the mighty triathlon this morning in Sag Harbor, and I saw those people coming out of the water. I used to do triathlons, and talk about age. It's such a reminder of how our lives have changed.
Normally for the many, many years I've gotten water, it was always been from Round Pond, but this was from our swimming pool. Which, as many of you know, has been a nightmare and a pleasure. It took twice as long and cost twice as much, but we're having so much fun. And just yesterday, my niece's husband's a coach, a basketball coach from Up Island. He brought 10 of his basketball players to hang out. First, we went to the ocean, which was amazing because of Hurricane Earl's, because it's very rough. We were sliding in that. Then we went to the pond and went kayaking. Then we went in the pool and had chicken fights and hamburgers and also mooncakes because it's Chinese Autumn Festival. And then to Sag Harbor on Long Wharf. So we covered all the water, and I am so grateful to live in a place surrounded by water.
Yes.
My water is from Long Beach, where I love, love, love to swim.
My water is from the Atlantic Ocean. So last night, the full moon rose for the harvest moon. And actually, it took a while to spot it. There was fog on the horizon. So we're looking like what's supposed to be out there somewhere until finally this very faint red disc appeared. And there it was. It's pretty reliable, actually.
Well, my water is from the Adirondacks. It's a place called Brandreth Lake. We've gone for many, many years, 45 years. I've gone, Mark's gone all his life. And the water is so pure that we can swim in it and drink it.
So this water is a memory of ice. From Iceland and on the crystal, it's called the Crystal Beach. And the ice is like a diamonds because it is over 800 years old, perhaps formed in the glaciers, certainly formed in the glaciers at the time, from snow at the time of Leif Erikson. This is for Leif. I want to tell you, I enjoyed it best in a glass of Irish whiskey.
Hi, my virtual water is from Hull, Massachusetts. It's a little peninsula before you get to the Cape. And it was a celebration of my brother's 70th birthday. So we took this trip and it brought back many memories of childhood, because that's where I spent every single year of my youth. And this is the virtual water from Hull, Massachusetts.
My virtual water is from southeastern Colorado in my hometown. It's not in the mountains. It's out on the high desert or the plains at 4,800 feet. And water is very precious there. Many of the ranchers in the area had to sell their herds because there's not enough rain to grow grass for their cattle. So it's very precious, and people fight over it in Colorado.
Two kinds of water I am mentioning. One is the Baltic Sea in Poland, by which I grew up and was born. And the other one, so that's the Baltic Sea, imagine. The other one is Polish vodka. Lots and lots of that kind of water is being drank in Poland, because yesterday Iga Świątek won US Open. Yes.
This water is to honor the bays we are surrounded by, the ocean that we live in and love. And every time I take a walk at either place, I am reminded how lucky we all are to be living where we are and to have both of them so accessible to us. So many people travel so far to be here for it.
Thank you. Do we have anybody who's joining us online who wants to share?
Yes, I'd like to share. It's Tuna. I'm in Florida, and I have to say, I realize how blessed I am that here in Florida, the groundwater, Elizabeth has a well, the groundwater is only about 15 feet down to the well. And I've done a lot of plantings. Those of you who know me know I'm a crazy gardener. And I'm delighted to realize that through really no great plan of my own, the two places that I hang out most here in Florida and up in New York are some of the most fortunate places for not having water problems. So a blessing to the water.
I would like to just say really quickly that I would like to say water. I want to give my water, and this water is a symbol of water coming from a fire hydrant. For people, for the kids that I knew who never had the blessing of being at a shoreline or looking at a glacier cut water hole, or even just stand in a clean puddle of water.
And anyone left in this room who'd like to share?
Well, this is water from Gin Beach in Montauk, where there was a triathlon earlier this summer, and I swam in Gin Beach and actually finished it. Not, I was way back in the pack, but way, way, way back in the pack. But that's how I celebrated, because I, too, have turned 80 recently. But I tell myself that actually I am a Martian, and as Mars takes 2 years to go around the sun, I'm really only 40.
Jim Beach in Montauk, if you know where it is, it's you go out East Lake Drive out to the Sound, and most people think it was named that because of the rum running business, but that's not true. It was Gin Beach long before that, and it refers to a gin used to be called a contrivance, you know, like the cotton gin, and they had a contrivance there to keep the animals in a certain place so they didn't wander off, and that was the gin, and that was called Gin Beach.
Moving slowly and leaving silence.
I feel compelled to share. I'll drop water in, but I'll put in three spills for us to reflect on drought and flooding and access. And because I have lots of numbers that I can't keep in my head, I need to stand behind this podium. But our drought water is for all of the places across the globe. We are in currently a significant and sustained global drought. From Europe, where drought is finding, uncovering World War II relics in receding rivers, to the south of Europe, where crops and livelihood and global food supply is being affected by drought. In the US, this is the worst drought in 1,200 years, drying up rivers and lakes and reservoirs. We know here in Suffolk County, we have been in a water emergency for most of the summer. That's here on the East End for most of the summer. It's been extended to the rest of Suffolk County. But in the country, 43% of Americans are living amidst drought. To the Horn of Africa, which is experiencing the worst drought in 40 years, pushing millions of people into famine. And at the same time that we are experiencing drought, we are experiencing the ravages of flooding. 21 dead in Tennessee this month, 20,000 people displaced in Chad this summer, 40,000 homes destroyed, 300 in Northwestern Europe, more than 80 in Turkey, 300 killed in China, record monsoon rains right now in Pakistan that have so far killed more than 1,400 people, washing away homes and bridges and crops. Everything, millions of people displaced. And we already heard about access here in this country, the water crisis in Jackson, so many echoes of the water crisis in Flint, not even a decade ago. Years of neglect and poor management and failure to invest. Weeks upon weeks of undrinkable water. We cannot tell this story without also noticing that this is a majority Black city like Flint. And those are not accidental. The uneven impact of climate and racism in this country and across the globe. We are in the midst of a crisis. We are surrounded by water, and we notice the power and the devastating damage that it can do, but also the ravages when we lose it. We are in awe. I am in awe most days when I go to the ocean of its sheer beauty and magic.
that I get to participate in. Like our story earlier, there is no easy moral. There is no simple way to tie this up in a bow and say, water good, water bad, water yay. But all of those are true. Water good, water bad, water yay. These are long brewing problems, global problems, and they will take long-term global solutions. And there is urgency right now for action. And what are we to do in the midst of that? Not only cry and lament or wring our hands, not go home and feel bad and terrible and guilty, all of which are appropriate, none of which are permanent. What is for us to do is to recognize the beauty and the magic and the majesty and the awe of the water and the ways that we are interconnected with it. And we say interconnected a lot, the ways that we are interdependent with this water and this planet and all of the people who share it with us. So we remember those things in the morning. We remember those things when we travel. We remember those things when we vote. We remember those things when we think about our resources and how we share them. This is a magic and beautiful home. And we get to enjoy it, even as we remember the ways that we are responsible for it. And we do our best every day to live up to both parts of that story. This last song that we will sing together, this one, Rising, if you are able or willing, maybe you'll sway along with me to Blue Boat Home.
Standing on these mountains and plains, far away from the rolling ocean, still my dry land heart can say, I've been sailing all my life now, never harbor or port have I known. The wide universe is the ocean I travel, and the earth is my blue boat home. Sun, my sail, and moon, my rudder, as I ply the starry sea, leaning over the edge in one, casting questions into the deep, drifting here with my ship's companions, all we kindred pilgrim souls, making our way by the lights of the heavens in our beautiful blue boat. To the waves upholding me, hear the great winds urging me on. Greet the infinite sea before me. Sing the sky my sailor's song. I was born upon the fathoms. Never harbor or port have I known. The wide universe is the ocean I travel, and the earth is my blue boat home. The wide universe is the ocean I travel, and the earth is my blue.
If you are joining us in Zoom, the Zoom room will remain open for a few moments as the service ends for informal conversation. If you're joining us here in the meeting house, we hope you'll stay for some snacks and conversation, some fellowship. We have a special ice cream treat today, so stay for some ice cream. And if you haven't already, please sign our guest book so that someone from our Care and Connection team can be in touch with you. We hope you'll join us next week for a special service. Members and friends from this congregation will share their wisdom and experience with aging. I know. And if you are visiting for the first time or the 500th time, if you find yourself in agreement with our values and our principles, our mission, if you appreciate the warmth and love in this room and this building, we hope you'll find and make a home here. Our closing words as we extinguish our chalice from Cale Price: it starts with a drop and then a trickle, a burble, a rush of water bubbling toward its destination, and finally, the wide, endless sea. All rivers run to the sea. Today, you brought your water poured into a common bowl. Though our experiences have differed, these waters mingle, signifying our common humanity. Today, you came and shared in this sacred community. May you depart this space, hearts filled with hope for new beginnings, a fresh start. Go forth, but return here to this community, where rivers of tears may be shed, where dry souls are watered, where your joy bubbles, where your life cup overflows, where deep in your spirit, you have found in this place a home. All rivers run to the sea. We extinguish our chalice with the words, I hope, on your order of service. We extinguish this flame. And one final word or sound from Robert Sechrist. Thank you.
Hmm.